Good evening, everyone. Welcome. Welcome to the lecture tonight. Our guest speaker this evening is Dan Wood. He is a principal and co-founder of Work AC with Amol Andros. And their firm has achieved international acclaim for projects ranging from master plans to buildings across the United States as well as in Asia, Africa, and Europe, such as the master plan for the New Holland Island Cultural Center in St. Petersburg, Russia, Wyden Kennedy's 50,000 square feet, three-story offices in New York, the Blaffer Museum in Houston, Texas, the Children's Museum of Arts in Manhattan, and the Edible Schoolyard in Brooklyn, to name just a few. Currently in Africa, Work AC is building its winning competition entry for a new 20,000 square meter conference center in Gabon. So they do a lot of projects ranging from very small to very big master planning. And as an educator, Dan Wood has taught at Cornell, Princeton, Cooper Union, Columbia, Ohio State, the Norton School of Architecture, where we overlapped for one semester as colleagues in 2008 or 9, it's somewhere there, a long time ago. And then and also UC Berkeley, where he was the Friedman Distinguished Chair, and then at the Yale School of Architecture, where he held the Louis Kahn's Chair. And currently, he's a visiting professor at the University of Pennsylvania School of Architecture. So Dan, he struck me as this, if you know him, he's full of energies and ideas. And he's in one person, he can do so much, like from building small projects, master planning, teaching, writing books. And so I told him I have this theory of him, how he could accomplish so much in one person. And so my nonsensical theory is that there's multiple person in him, embodying him in him, so it's so you can work with in human speed. But more sensible theory is that he has this character that's unafraid of anything and embracing everything. So he finds opportunities in creatively in everything. So that's why he can accomplish it so much. And I remember in Ohio, he used to tell us how he and Amol would critique each other's work to death. And then, so there's always a lot of creative energy around him, and full of fun as well. So all these attributes to his creative ingenuity, that's my whole theory. So tonight, we are honored to have him here to speak about Generation O, that's his conception, with different O themes, like Ozone, OMA, Overdose, and other O themes. So welcome, Dan Wood.
Clip it. I want that nice echoey sound. All right. Okay, how's the sound? Good and echoey? I called this lecture Generation O because, wow, this is awesome. I could be wearing anything. I called it Generation O because I have been thinking about this idea of our generation of architects or generation of people and like who we are and what we stand for. I think it's a very tricky, no problem. The lights will go out, doesn't matter. It's a tricky generation to get a handle on. I think a lot of people have observed that, but I feel like at this point we are all, you know, entering a more creative, more productive period of our careers. I think it's fine either way, really. Just, yeah, I think that's good. So I came up with this idea of Generation O, and I thought, like, since I'll have the lecture, that will be a good opportunity to really get all these thoughts in order, because it's a deadline. But I didn't make the deadline, so I don't really have any thoughts about it. But I did draw this diagram on the plane. So this was kind of, you know, I think that Generation X obviously is the generation that doesn't want to be a generation. It's the generation that if you ask most people whether they're Generation X or not, most people will tell you they're not, which is how you know that they are. And I think, you know, we're marked with a kind of sense of humor or irony, the ability to see two sides of a situation. It's also one of the smallest generations. And, you know, but at the same time, we are, let's say, the generation that ushered in the internet, that is living with climate change and passing on a lot of these things to you guys. So, you know, since this is the moment we're taking off, I feel like, you know, there have been numerous ways to think about our generation, or for ourselves, let's say. So there were groupings like Ordos, where 100 architects gathered together in the desert. I have a picture of that in a second. Firms that started in the 2000s. We started in 2003. The recent Chicago Biennial has about 120 of us, or different generations. And for us personally, being ex-OMAs, also is really something that defines us. So, you know, there are all these circles, and we somehow fit roughly within some of them and more easily within the others. But I do feel like our generation is characterized by... I feel like there are two things that we really need to concentrate on. That's what I'm going to present today, which is really this question of responsibility and a question of representation. And I should say that, you know, we're also at a moment in our firm. My partner and wife just became the dean of Columbia's Graduate School of Architecture. We're at a moment where we are taking on these kind of larger responsibilities and trying to kind of push our generation. And also as an office, we're kind of in between, let's say, the initial projects and the medium-sized projects and trying to figure out what our next project is. And, you know, I feel like for many years, this has been a good depiction of our generation of architects, kind of a group of us dressed in black, alone in a desert, kind of together, but also kind of on our own, trying to figure out where our site for our building is, or what our program is, or what our project is. But this question of responsibility, I think, comes not only because of climate change, but also just the increasing urbanization of our world, increasingly having to deal with sites and contexts such as this, incredible density, incredible fast change, without much planning or thinking. And then we're also working in this context of the architects of the previous generation who kind of embraced bigness as a model, ever-increasing enlargement, working at a scale. And, you know, I think that for us, we see that things can't keep getting bigger. And in fact, I think that the reason why we do big projects and small projects is not so much to do bigger projects, but also to make sure that we continue to do the small projects. That there is something about scale and about smallness, actually, that is very important. And I think that got forgotten in the mad rush of the last 15, 20 years, let's say. Just more examples. So the other question is one of representation. I do think that increasingly architects are working internationally, and we certainly are that as well. And often that work takes on this quality of having to represent a culture. And so, you know, either in Dubai, I guess that's why the Dubai slide is in here, either in Dubai or even in Taiwan, this question of architecture's role in representing culture comes up again and again in practice, but is not something that's ever discussed in academics or in theory. And so it kind of, you know, somehow after the the 70s, this idea of representation, that architecture could represent anything, was discredited in academia. And yet, in practice, we're constantly asked to represent, you know. And so you end up with things like this, or buildings with native patterns on it. And it becomes a very much a surface acknowledgement of culture. And I would say that, you know, this kind of moment of extreme specificity combined with cheesiness comes at a moment where the world is facing some very large problems, and that in a way we need to find new forms of representation that are not so much based on nostalgia or a historicism or a kind of, let's say, a very limited cultural reading, but that embrace more architecture's role to imagine new futures and to create, let's say, more unifying conditions. So then, you know, so our counter to this kind of project is projects like this. This is our plug out from a few years ago, where different housing typologies and different exterior spaces, from farming to heated campgrounds, are kind of cantilevered out over a street in a way to kind of find new forms and to allow people also to find their own positions. And that at the same time it has this kind of big scale, vibrant structural ingenuity. It's also all about community. So all of the, because we needed structure to cantilever out all these housing typologies, we created this kind of vast interior of new forms of community space, which are based on infrastructure. And so I think for us, in comparison, let's say, to conditions like this, of extreme population growth, extreme pollution, we really want to present a kind of forward-looking, positive outlook of the future that finds new forms that are more reflective of environmental concerns, but that also embrace the specificities of place and the role of the individual. So now I'm just going to show some work, I think. This is the project in 2008 that really started us on our trajectory. This was the first moment where we were able to take a project. So the only requirements for this project were that it provides shade, seating, and water. And everything else was up to the architect. This is for PS1 MoMA in 2008. And so we came up with the idea of a new form of urban infrastructure, a kind of floating farm bridge that we made out of recyclable tubes that grew 51 different types of fruits and vegetables all summer long. And for us was a kind of moment to state a position about infrastructure and growing and new ways of thinking about living in the city. And that followed with several other projects, master plans, and things like that. And that all kind of coalesced in a book called 49 Cities, which is just about to be re-released, where we took a number of visionary projects throughout history and reread them through a kind of ecological lens, so that each city is re-presented through drawing and analysis, and kind of bled of all its social... It's the weight of its kind of social reading, and really looked at simply in terms of how they work. So we kind of looked at all these cities in terms of the numbers to see how they performed, how much green space they had, what the population density was. And this really, for us, set up a way of thinking about cities and nature. It led to a number of discoveries about the role of infrastructure, for example, but also the relationship between a city and the green space around it, which really influenced a lot of our thinking and work. And so then in 2012, we were asked by MoMA to kind of develop our own 50th city, and that was for Kaiser, Oregon. So this was part of an exhibition called Foreclosed, Rehousing the American Dream. We were given the site of Kaiser, Oregon. And we basically went back and tried to think through a lot of these issues of the relationship between infrastructure and cities and green space, and through some of the projects that we had looked at in 49 Cities. And this is Ebenezer Howard's diagram from 1902, because the exhibition was really about reimagining the suburbs, which is a condition probably many of you know intimately, and was something that we had never really thought about. And so what we wanted to do was try to kind of unpack the suburbs and go all the way back to the beginning and kind of rethink why people move to the suburbs, what possibility the suburbs could have. And for us, this project, this is Garden City by Ebenezer Howard, is really the start of this idea that people don't necessarily have to live in the hinterlands and they don't have to live in the city, but that they could live in a place that is kind of the best of both worlds. So for him, the 19th century, the kind of pre-industrial, or you know, the city of the Industrial Revolution was a very dirty, polluted place where there was high crime, low wages, health problems, et cetera. But also the countryside of the late 19th century was also a terrible place to live. So people were very poor, you had to work all the time, there was no possibility for social advancement, no culture, et cetera. So he kind of asked this famous question in the middle, the people, where will they go? And then he postulated this idea that there could be something called the town country. And if you look, you know, the town country is just an amazing place. Where you have low rents and low rates, low prices, high wages, plenty to do, and my favorite, you have no sweating. No sweating in the suburbs. No smoke, no slums, etc. So, you know, in a way, it was the beginning of the suburb was this idealized state where you would have the best of both worlds. And of course, 100 years later, we're at a place where the suburbs, or what became the town country, is the worst of both worlds. And so what we set out to do was to kind of take this idea of the town country again and see if we could do it better. And what we ended up with, or our kind of goal was, to create a place that was five times as dense as the neighboring suburbs of Kaiser, Oregon, so that had all the kind of urban vitality of living close to each other, the diversity of different types of housing, et cetera, cultural institutions, mixed use, retail, et cetera, but that at the same time had also three times as much open space. The suburbs, while they appear quite green, actually have extremely low amounts of open space, and most of the open space is simply lawns, which you're not allowed to use for anything because you have to mow them all the time. And so we wanted to create not only a variety in terms of living space and urban space, but also a variety in terms of green space. And we were able to do that through this configuration. So you see the kind of typical suburbs on the left. The site was in a kind of big box retail site that was all paved, even though it was really an amazing position at the height of the aquifer. And so we kind of proposed to move all the proposed new residents of Kaiser to this 14,000, they were anticipating 14,000 new people. And so through this kind of situation of piers, we were able to create this kind of continuous urban grid street fabric with buildings on both sides that created a kind of continuous urban experience that also, say you were to turn a corner or go out a back alley, had a continuous green space here, providing, kind of rebuilding some of the ecologies and ecosystems of this big box retail site before it was big box retail. So creating a Douglas fir forest and oak savanna, we worked with a landscape ecologist to kind of rediscover what the flora and fauna would have been of this area, so that through the use of bridges and housing that was raised up off the ground, animal and plant life has a kind of also a continuous experience. So by utilizing section, we were able to create both types of spaces and also create a variety of different green spaces throughout the projects, from private gardens to parks and public spaces to this kind of idea that there is also a kind of larger wild nature. Then that was combined with this shows that kind of series of different green spaces. And then this is the project. So you see very, very dense, large-scale housing combined with a kind of perimeter of densified suburban houses, three stories tall, that we kind of traced from a suburban housing book and squished to make them three stories. And then each of the larger housing elements not only provided different types of green space and different types of housing, from live-work to places for extended families, affordable housing, et cetera, but also each housing unit was an element of infrastructure for the city. And so, in a way, you realized your role in the community by realizing your building's role in the infrastructure, or there was a kind of metaphoric relationship there. So, for example, there would be greenhouses. The vegetable waste from there would be combined from vegetable waste from everyone's houses and brought to a composting facility. Methane gas would be brought off the compost. The compost would go to the farm fields. The methane gas would go to a fuel cell. The fuel cell would power the water turbines, the water pressure would be provided in towers, et cetera. So we utilize the infrastructural functions of each of the different housing types to create different forms and different experiences. So for example, this was the water treatment center. And all of this was kind of green infrastructure. So we were really working with civil engineers and ecological experts to find what was the newest technology in terms of green infrastructure for cities. And so this is a natural water filtration system that has three different phases to it. The first two phases are the kind of dirty phases, and those took place underground. So the whole building kind of ramps up to create a kind of underground treatment facility. But then the last phase is to have the water sit and you can treat it with natural organisms, and also fish are quite helpful for cleaning it. So it creates a kind of series of fish ponds. And through the creation of these fish ponds, which is the last phase in the water treatment, we kind of invented this row house housing, which had big public yards on one side and fish ponds on the other. And then the fish are completely edible, et cetera. So that kind of led to that different type. So here you see the underground and the above ground and the ponds. The engineers also told us we needed water pressure. We needed some big water towers to get the pressure up for the settlement. And so we thought, since we're bringing the water up, we'll create towers. So since we needed the towers, we created live-work towers. And then since the water needed to come down, we created these waterfalls inside the building so that infrastructure is not only providing the kind of inspiration for the housing type, but also creating all these new urban experiences, such as the interior waterfall. And then this is the most famous. It's the compost hill, we called it, but our interns called it the shit mountain. But basically, to collect methane, it was not sewage. It was vegetable waste. To collect methane, you need a big dome where the methane gases come up and then be collected. And since we had a dome, we basically created this series of terraced housing, and all that housing was duplexes with terraces at either level. And so you had a kind of alternating series of public terraces with a kind of skip-stop system that brought you up to the roof, and then private terraces. So every other terrace is public and every other one is private. And then at the roof, the only excess from methane collection is heat. And so we utilize the heat at the roof to create heated outdoor swimming pools for the community. And then some of the buildings were simply lifted up to allow the plants and the animals' life to kind of continue underneath. And then this one, we created a series of kind of dangerous courtyards for bears and goats. And then this, as you see, is that kind of continuous perimeter. So we also ran full economic analysis on this with our economists. And because a third of the housing was in this stick-built, three-story party wall construction, it was quite cheap. And in essence, that combined with the fact that, unlike most suburban developments, we had no curved roads, that saved about 20% on infrastructure, believe it or not. That kind of allowed the construction of most of the units to be cheap enough to pay for the affordable housing and the larger buildings. The infrastructure itself paid for itself over 40 years, so that we put down as like an investment for developers. And then that's the project. So skipping over completely from Kaiser, Oregon to Russia, this is a project that we just finished. It's a master plan for St. Petersburg, Russia. For a new cultural center on an island really right within the historic center of the city, which had a series of these old warehouses. So, you know, in a way, just to show the kind of range that we're working on, you know, this was really all about a kind of World Heritage Monument and how these warehouses, which had been used for drying wood and been unoccupied for more than 200 years, could be rethought of and reused as a place for public space. And like Minneapolis, it's very sunny and warm all the time. and occasionally really snowy and cold. So also to create a cultural center where in the wintertime you can enjoy the island as much as you can in the 30 days of summer. So this is the these are warehouses. So the idea was each one would host enough wood for like an entire tree's worth of wood or something for one part of the ship, and they would dry them vertically. They thought they could save time doing that, which never worked. But then the warehouses were abandoned, and so we proposed a series of cuts and moves in the roofs to kind of open up these spaces and create a kind of continuous interior experience of the buildings, and to really create new forms of public space. So the ground floor was galleries, museums, some city agencies, retail, of course. And then the upper levels were private space, either housing in one case or spec offices for tech companies, things like that. But then the attic space, where there was very little windows, obviously, but they had these huge windows, became a kind of secondary public space, this kind of interior promenade. And this was, again, combined with infrastructure. So what we find is that by kind of harnessing infrastructure for architectural means, we're able to kind of make it do double duty. But, you know, it's also a good argument to create new forms of public space, because we couldn't dig underneath the buildings for all the cabling and the ducting and stuff because the buildings were too fragile. So we had to run it through the buildings. And since we were running huge amounts of infrastructure through the attic, it was quite simple to propose a kind of public promenade along the top. And so this basically is that kind of infrastructural promenade that runs through the top levels of the buildings. And then we cut large holes in the roof to create light spaces for light and gardens and things like that. And so we were able to move a large amount of public program also up to the attics, like theaters and gallery spaces that didn't need a lot of natural light, and then also views down into some of the fabrication labs and things like that. So here you can see the kind of diagram of how infrastructure was used for that, and then the kind of section that shows how it goes, and then, you know, different details at ground level to really invite the public in, yet keep them out of the weather at times. And then to propose and then basically, so that was this kind of range there, and a new public park in the middle, and then one new public building, which is a major museum for the garage, which we wanted to function as part of the park on the inside, so it's a kind of continuation of the landscape. And then as you move around it, it really becomes part of the city on the other, a kind of more civic presence. And we had to work directly with the landmarks people and things. So the idea was to create what they wanted to do was kind of complete the ensemble. There was always a plan for another warehouse building here. So to complete the ensemble in one side, but pull one of the roofs out to create this continuity of public experience, and then shift it to create space for this public balloon and things like that. And that formed the museum, so that from one side, it really reads as a kind of continuation in different materials of the bulk of the kind of civic presence of these warehouses. And then as you move around it, you have this kind of slope down to the public experience on the garden side. And then in the wintertime, this pool in the middle was used for testing boats, testing model boats, when it was owned by the Russian Navy. It's an amazing site. Mendeleev discovered the periodic table of the elements there. And the idea was that in this kind of very horizontal city, you would have one moment where you could go up and see things vertically from this balloon. So this idea of kind of buildings that change form and shape depending on what side you look at it, and that are kind of punctured by moments of public experience, it's been something that we've been working with lately. This is a competition for a new museum on the campus of UC Davis, which really is nice all the time. And it was a kind of interesting condition on the edge of the campus, visible from this highway, which is between Sacramento and San Francisco, and also, you know, obviously a major part of the campus with this public quadrangle here. And so it was a building that also had two sides, and it had to be conceived of from the highway as well as from the city. They wanted something that was really visible that announced this brand new institution. And so because of this, the shape of the site, which was really, strange parallelogram. We just pulled up the middle and let the two sides go down in these kind of triangles, so that from the highway you had this kind of large public space where you got hints of what was going on inside the building. These are exterior spaces that are punched through. And then as you move around it, as it goes to the campus, it becomes much more inviting, coming all the way down to the ground, and the roof becomes this kind of public experience where you can move up to some of these upstairs places. And then through the awning on the campus side becomes a kind of more institutional building with a large canopy that kind of announces the entrance and invites the students in. They wanted it to be a place where students really felt at home to kind of hang out and be exposed to art, but also they had a classroom that could be used by any department, et cetera. And so the whole building is kind of infused with public space. We created this, what we called the tribune, which was a very steep set of steps, similar to what you're sitting on, where art could be displayed in a different way, but also students would come in there without going into the gallery and be able to do homework or have meetings, et cetera. So to really make art much more a part of student life. And then because of the weather and California and this idea of kind of integrating public into all aspects of the building, we cut two openings through the building so that you could actually move through it to different parts on campus. So you have these kind of two outdoor spaces which pass entirely through the building, which creates a kind of sculpture court. This is an artist in residence and a kind of studio for the art school. And then the other, which is more formal for events, that basically opens up to this big auditorium at the second level. Back to New York. So we finished PS1 in 2008, and for us it was the kind of ideal project to launch all this thinking about cities and food and plants. And we were almost immediately upon tearing it down, contacted by someone to start thinking about the first edible schoolyard in New York City, which is a program that was started by Alice Waters, the chef and food activist in Berkeley, about 15 years ago, which introduces elementary school children to growing and cooking organic food. And it's a program that integrates this idea of growing and cooking into the curriculum. And these are what we're doing is we're doing one of these in every borough of New York City. And we're looking for schools that are in neighborhoods that have a very small amount of green space compared to the rest of the city, with high amounts of health problems associated with food issues such as obesity or diabetes, kind of food deserts. So these become these kind of satellite programs. And basically two or three times a month, the students are here either growing in the garden or cooking in the kitchen. And integrating it with whatever they're studying, whether it's science, studying the science of how water boils, or mathematics with the measuring, or art history, or art making. If they're studying Native Americans, they're cooking Native American food. So it's completely integrated with what they're learning, and really an amazing program to kind of force a change in the way they think. So they see these students two or three times a month, every month for 7 years, which is kind of amazing throughout their time in the school. And so the first thing we're doing in these projects is tearing up parking lots or rooftops and creating these organic gardens with the garden teachers. And there's a kind of outdoor classroom always. And then building these buildings, which is a kind of interesting typology. Obviously, we had to make a lot of translations from Berkeley, California to New York. The weather was one. You know, the kids are in school mostly in the wintertime, so we really had to integrate greenhouses, but also a kind of teaching classroom that was set up like a classroom, but also familiar to the students, so that what they learn here, they could bring home to their kitchens. And we also wanted the building to be pedagogical in terms of sustainability and green architecture. And so we used a gray water treatment system, a very high efficiency HVAC system, a composting toilet, and things like that. And those systems form part of the project. So those three elements, the greenhouse, the kitchen classroom, and all the sustainable infrastructure, become the kind of three elements of the building design, which you see clearly here. So each one has its own material and coloration, but then all three of them work together. So the roofs are completely aligned so that rainwater collects here and is brought down to the cistern, which is one of the cylindrical shapes in the building. And so here you see that from the other side. So this is the composting toilet, the entrance, and HVAC, the tool shed, and the chicken shack, and this cistern. We created this kind of flower pattern, working with very inexpensive cementitious shingles that you saw kind of, you see on row houses and buildings around. It's just a cement shingle. But we worked with the manufacturer to kind of create a smaller overlap, so it becomes a tighter pattern so that the shingles itself form a kind of pixel pattern, and that continues into the greenhouse here. And you see those colors are repeated in the kitchen classroom. So you see we used really domestic scaled things, which meant that it's not an industrial kitchen, but it's also not child-sized, so this is at a normal height, so that really there's a real level of intersection between their kitchens at home and the kitchens where they're learning here. And that's that project. And this is the second. So that was in Brooklyn. That's the first one. The second one is under construction now in Harlem, where we're doing these planters that we're giving out to other schools. So it's a kind of experiment in how to do this at a smaller scale as well, so that smaller schools can benefit. So these planters are the kind of first test. And now we have a kind of factory churning these out for other schools. And then we're doing a rooftop garden there with a greenhouse and using the existing building as the kitchen classroom. These are the planters. And so a lot of these ideas about nature and urbanism and systems and infrastructure all kind of have come to a head in our project in Gabon that Lisa mentioned. So Gabon is a Central African country here. It's right on the equator. The equator is an interesting place. Obviously, there's no solar orientation. It doesn't matter if you're facing south or north. The sun rises at 6 a.m. every day and sets at 6 p.m. every day. It's 80 degrees average during the day. It's 80 degrees average during the night. There's no wind. There's no earthquakes. It just rains all the time. Gabon is also host to some of the most amazing natural resources in the world. 14% of the country is dedicated national parks. That's the highest of any country in the world. It's all but inaccessible. It's an oil-based economy. And the president, our client, was in the midst of kind of rebranding Gabon. He sees the end of the oil economy, and he wants to encourage Gabon as a place of a kind of gateway to Africa. It's stable. It's a stable government. It's a democracy. And so to kind of encourage debate, but also tourism, and to utilize natural resources in a way that's very unique in Africa, which is to protect them instead of exploit them. And so his number two person is an ecologist who spent 25 years living in the jungles of Gabon and studying the flora and fauna. So it's a kind of progressive idea. And the city itself, as you can see, is extremely green. So 90% of the population lives in one city on the coast, and the vast majority of the country is uninhabited rainforest. There's a second smaller city, and really between those, it's almost everybody in the country. And as you can see, even in this city, which is fairly dense, it's also very green and right on the ocean. And Gabon has a very long history of engagement with what we call a kind of off-modernism. So it's not the kind of classic modernism, it's tropical modernism, you know, where there's a lot of exterior spaces and openings to the outside, which these are all buildings that are in Libreville. And then after that, really experimenting with a kind of organicism. So this is Marcelo D'Olivo, who was a signatory to Bruno Zevi's Organicist Manifesto and a contemporary of Paolo Solari's, interested in organic architecture, sustainability, green urbanism, et cetera, who did the master plan for the city, and almost all of his built work is in Libreville and Gabon. So it was also interesting to kind of discover this kind of alternative modernist history, which was existing in the country, and this real sense of optimism in these kind of alternatives that we wanted to channel in the design of our building. The building site is in this kind of huge park, bigger than Central Park, just at the northern edge of the city, one of the highest locations in the city. So the city kind of starts here and is looking up at the site, which is here. This is the kind of diplomatic park. There's villas for dignitaries, and the UN is in there. There's a presidential receiving place, small military base. It's a kind of interesting combination of diplomatic zone and public park. So the idea was that the building would be seen from below, from the city. So as I was talking about in the beginning, in this idea of representation, the president wanted this building to represent Gabon and represent this new image that he had for the country to the world. It's a conference center for the African Union, where every other year, every head of state of every African country will meet together to discuss issues common to the continent. And so he wanted the building to kind of represent the country as it emerges on the world stage. And so we approached it with this kind of alternative modernist idea that we would represent the country not through a kind of historical pastiche, but through a kind of embrace of the ecology of the country. And so the building is organized, it's a circle, so the auditorium is in the center for 1,000 people, and then it's organized around three gardens, which represent three distinct ecologies of the country. And then the roof is tilted so that from below you can look up from the city and you see the three gardens. And in the middle we have water collection, so while it rains every day, it doesn't rain for long, but all the water will collect on the roof. It then gets channeled into a weir and becomes a waterfall in one of the gardens, where it's recollected as a gray water system and used throughout the building. And so you can see, I think, in this project how even in our smaller projects like PS1, the idea of PS1 was also a garden that was tilted so you could see it from the city below, get translated to this very large scale, or items like the waterfall in Nature City, which was a purely theoretical project, get translated into this very real project. So this shows the water system. This is, you know, the kind of technical diagram of how the waterfall is used with the cistern to then feed all the toilets and the building irrigation and building washing systems, etc. And this idea of transparency of infrastructure and transparency of intent is carried through to the building itself. So it's clad entirely in limestone louvers, which are fixed because the sun is essentially fixed. It's always coming from the same angle, which shade the entire building and allow us to have large window openings behind. So this project will be LEED Gold. So basically by shading the facade, we're able to kind of create as much light and openings as we want. This is a mock-up that we're doing right now in Italy of the stone panels. It's all straight cuts because the radius is so big that it kind of makes the curve without it. And you see the different angles depending on the height. This is the system for connecting them. And between the louvers and the building wall and the windows, we created this promenade similar to what we were doing in Russia. But it's a kind of shaded walkway that moves behind the louvers and all around the circle of the building that is the main way that you visit the three gardens. And here's a working drawing diagram of that promenade, so you kind of go up and down. The idea is that inside the building we have all these formal meeting spaces, large halls, small halls, breakout rooms, press rooms, but that at the end of the day, you know, as it starts to cool down from 80 to 78 degrees, you know, you can grab your colleague or your enemy and kind of take a walk around the building and work out things in a kind of more informal way. And so it has seating, it has artworks oriented into it, and this is the kind of view of what that looks like. And you get views out over the city and out over the landscape, and of course into the garden. So here's the waterfall down into the garden. And then, yeah, this shows the kind of openings behind. And then that's the project. So the engineering is quite complex. The limes, because the roof is essentially a facade, we created a 1 meter space underneath those louvers where we take care of all the equipment, the bathroom exhaust, the smoke exhaust, the emergency stairs, et cetera, all kind of empty into this zone so that the roof becomes a kind of pristine plane. So the limestone kind of covers the roof as well. And these are the three gardens. So each one represents a different ecology. This is the kind of rainforest garden with the waterfall. This is a mock-up of the waterfall. So it's about three times as big as this. But we had to do a mock-up so that we would know how to create the crenellation at the face of it so that we got the correct waterfall look. This one is a kind of orchard with an auditorium below it. We're kind of working with ecologists there to rediscover some edible plants that aren't normally eaten. And here you see how the building is configured. So the hall is in the middle, right under that water collection, kind of representing the ocean, if you will, and the gardens represent the land. So these are the three gardens. We have one auditorium under a garden. And then this hexagon organizes all the ancillary spaces. And then the public spaces are really simply the spaces that exist between this kind of very tight core and the gardens. And they're kind of quite neutral. So here, for example, is the main entry lobby. So you come in, you can either go to the left in the 350 auditorium or the right, or straight up to the auditorium, or straight in front of you into the main auditorium. This is the largest ancillary auditorium. And that's a view of that space. So that's all kind of clad in just light white. And then the gardens are clad with these bronze tiles with a kind of mortar. And then that hexagon space is a polycarbonate wall with lighting behind it. So this provides the light and then reflects off the gardens. So you really kind of occupy that space between light and reflection. And then inside the main auditorium, it's all local wood, sourced sustainably. And then kind of echoing the water and the ocean of the roof, the kind of the wood panels rise and lower to conceal the lighting and the access panels and everything. So this shows that condition in a model. And then each auditorium is associated with one of the gardens. So the orchard auditorium kind of has this feeling of roots and being underneath. The rainforest garden has a rainforest auditorium that has a kind of tree canopy and these kind of vertical glass shafts that conceal the lighting and create this kind of tree feeling. And then the Inselberg, which is this kind of rocky landscape that you find in the mountains, is the most technological space. And then other ancillary spaces have their own identity. This is the press room, which is a kind of perfect ellipse, but as the ellipse hits the cone of the exterior shape, you get this kind of cutout for the lighting. And then this is the restaurant up at the top, which opens up at the bar onto the roof. So where the water collects is a kind of fountain, and you can go out there onto the roof. This is the mechanical diagram, as you can see. Clear. This is the state of construction. The piles are all completed and all the steel is done, but it's Africa, so who knows when it will really be done. So jetting back to New York City, another recent project. This is headquarters for Wieden and Kennedy. And I think it just, you know, for me, it's this idea of scale and really thinking through experience. And for us here, this was an opportunity to really think about work and how people work. And in a way to kind of counteract, so Wieden Kennedy, basically, they have the three floors in the middle of this, the top middle of this building in New York City. So it's a completely interior project. And we wanted to kind of counteract the Google model of ping pong tables and fun. And I think this is an ad agency. Incredibly creative people. These are the guys who brought you the Old Spice ads, for example. So, like, creative, fun, playful people who told us, like, we don't need ping pong, you know, we don't need fun, we need to work because, you know, we are quite confident in our ability to be creative. What we really need is space to collaborate and to work. And also to kind of rethink the endless expansion model. So this is about scale and efficiency. So we wanted to create a really dense condition in a way, you know, so comparing with Google's NYC headquarters, many, you know, more people stacked in. And to do that in order to create, so this is their Portland office. Yellow is open office space and green are common areas. This was the condition of their New York office for the ad agency when we got there. So tons of offices, but almost no community space. And this is a company that really works in pairs. You know, you always have an art director, like Mad Men. Just imagine Mad Men. You know, a lot of collaboration. And so by kind of densifying the offices, so you see we went from 45 to 36% as the company expanded, we were able to open up huge amounts of space for collaboration and really to able to rethink collaboration at every scale, from the individual, so we have spaces for one or two people to meet privately in these little phone booths, and also provide all different places. You know, it's a kind of, for us, this was a new idea about flexibility. So instead of having one kind of generic room that can do many things, we wanted to provide many specific rooms that can do various things. So each group of 20 to 25 people is given a collection of all these different types of rooms. So that we had lounges, you know, with kind of comfortable furniture, more traditional conference rooms, places to have stand-up meetings. So these are desks where you can kind of lay everything out, meet with your team, standing up very quickly, and then go back to work, and then more formal conference rooms, and a series of spaces for the whole agency. So here you see, for example, that very small scale. And the idea is the smaller the space, the brighter the wallpaper. So that's the space for two people. Here's the stand-up desk in the foreground. This is one of the lounges. All the lounges are raised up off the ground, so you have this sense of privacy, even though they're open to the space. This is the more traditional room. And also really working with transparency to make sure that light, you had this sense of light and connection, even though the rooms were enclosed. More traditional rooms, this is our homage to the Whitney. And then outfitting every single space as a place for work. So this is the kitchen, for example. And then on the other side, to really create these large community spaces where the whole agency could kind of get together. And this for us was also an opportunity to push the idea of interior renovation as far as we could possibly go, because they were on three floors and they were worried about, you know, connectivity and being able to kind of gather. But we didn't want to kind of create an atrium. So we channeled Mata Clark and proposed to cut a series of large openings in the floors that would connect the spaces in a kind of dramatic way, but also a way, you know, so here you see the big hole in the front and then this smaller hole. So you got hints of what was going on the other floors, and everything was connected in a very clear way, but it wasn't all immediately visible and obvious. So there's a sense of discovery for the people who work there and also who are visiting. You get the sense that there's a lot of things going on. And we removed a column. In order to remove a column in New York, that's what you have to do. And then that becomes this kind of main stair. And so again, this idea that not everything is available to you immediately. You kind of come in at the back of the stair, and as you move around, you start to see the opening and get views up into the space. And this becomes this kind of main connecting piece. So that's that same shot with the second hole up there. But also a place for the whole company to gather together and have meetings or parties, whatever. They do a lot of partying. And then as you move up, all these kind of collective spaces are connected through this one element. So you move up, this is the bar. They represent Southern Comfort and Johnny Walker and Heineken, just like Mad Men. So they have a bar, and they have a lot of parties there. And then this is the second stair. So the materials also change as you move up. So this is a perforated metal stair. So this perforated metal is structural, which allowed us to keep the steel elements very, very thin. And then you move up this, so you have these glimpses all the way down into the library, which is clad in bamboo, and a kind of secret door and more office. We did have one gym space that can be transformed for screening, so there are chairs that are kept in there. We just made it like a high school gym as much as possible. And then after all these collective spaces, we really wanted to do also, because of our philosophy, to really have an outdoor space. So we looked at the roof, it was very expensive for them to rent. And so what we did is we convinced, this is a rental, by the way, they don't own this space. We convinced the landlord to let us remove all the windows at the southwest corner of the building and build a new facade inside and took the floor out here. So this used to be the interior windows in the middle of the building. And now you have this kind of garden, double height garden. These are all blueberry bushes, so in the summer they can go out there and snack. It's got super Wi-Fi, it's got music, you know, so they can work out there or do yoga, et cetera. So it becomes this kind of space, and it also kind of broadcasts the company to the outside. So here you see where we've removed them. It's a kind of amazing space. It's this outdoor room in the sky, in a way. I want to show some new project. This is a project in China we're doing with a group we call the Super Friends. So this is Scape, Kate Orff, Slab, this Jeffrey Johnson's the head of the China Lab at Columbia, and Zhu Pei, who's a great Chinese architect. And so we are working together on a series of projects, large-scale projects. This is a master plan for 7 university campuses. This is the site compared to university campuses around the world. This is Columbia there. I don't know. Your campus is probably pretty big, but not as big as this. So the idea was this is 7, and this is next to 20 other university campuses which were already under construction. So we didn't go too deep into what the hell they were doing, but they said they wanted 7 campuses. And so this was the site that they gave us right on this kind of salt river. This whole area was used for salt mining, you know, taking salt out of the ocean. And they proposed a kind of highway along the edge, and working with Scape, we proposed a much kind of more porous edge for the campuses, and actually removing a lot of the sites in order that the campuses could become even denser, and then to create a gradient from this kind of soft edge for the recreational fields and wetlands, really, to kind of control flooding and things like that, to a harder edge along the road. So the campuses kind of go from more urban on one side to more rural on the other, and then organizing each of the campuses along a pedestrian spine that also becomes denser as you go to the perimeter. And so that's what it looks like. And then this campus is already under construction, and we're working with a series of architects, including Mosa Mostafazi and Homa Fajadi and Alejandra Zeropolo and Zhu Pei to design the buildings. I won't go into it too deeply, but we're designing the library. So it's a perimeter of books organized on 12 floors. And that book perimeter is perforated by the reading rooms. So the reading rooms are the only openings, and those create these kind of tubes of public space moving through the atrium of the building, some of which are entirely outdoors. So again, we have this idea of kind of exterior spaces penetrated through the building to create these kind of series of tubes for the special reading rooms, which are extruded, and the building looks like that. So this is the section. So the interior reading rooms for privacy and the auditoriums are inside the tubes, and then the rest is a kind of public atrium for larger gatherings, the periodicals, things like that. And then this perimeter of books is the structure that holds it all up. So this is what it looks like inside one of those tubes, where we're using the exterior cladding, moving onto the inside. And then this is the inverse of that, this kind of atrium, which kind of, once you go up 12 stories, creates these kind of incredible, dizzying interiors, hopefully. And then it has all this sustainability stuff. I want to get to some other projects. So this is one of those tubes that's actually open to the air. So you have plants and trees that pass really through the middle of the building. And this is in Miami. I'll do very quickly. We were asked to design a parking garage, which is like the most shallow project. But in Miami, that's a big deal. We're designing a parking garage, not a parking garage. We're actually just designing the facade of a parking garage. So that's a fairly shallow project. We were given 4 feet of depth. So that's a very shallow project. And it's in Miami. So that makes it triply shallow. So what we decided to do was the deepest possible program. So in our 4 feet, we wanted to put everything from an art gallery to a lending library to a garden to a playground for children, electric car charging station, pet zone, graffiti, an auditorium, water collection system, DJ booth. listening zone, et cetera. And these are different options. We came up with this thing we call the ant farm. And so this kind of zone of stairs and spaces within this 4 feet of depth is kind of carved out to create this kind of human ant farm. So from the outside, you get glimpses of all the activity. And then inside, we're painting it pink, because it's Miami. And you see all the different things that are going on. And that project is also currently under construction and should be quite crazy. And so we're utilizing like the existing stair tower up here. This is the kids' climbing zone. There's like a net. There's nets where you can run across here. And that's where the DJ is. And then this is the auditorium. And we're not the only architect. There are five architects. So the building, we're only doing one fifth of the facade. So this is Jürgen Meyer, who we worked together on. To kind of create this kind of interlocking facade, and then you go down and there's a lot of other crazy stuff. this is another project. Forget that. That's a... Does that one will remain secret? Don't look. Don't look at this one. Yeah, I want to show this last project just because it's fun. So this was our entry for the Chicago Biennial, which is up right now. And because of working on 49 cities, we actually got, I was able to meet people like Yonah Friedman, Michael Webb, Peter Cook, you know, these kind of seminal figures from the 60s and 70s, working on this research about visionary urbanism. But really the people I was most excited to meet was Ant Farm, and their project Convention City is in the book. So this is Chip and Curtis. Doug Michaels is the third partner who died about 5 years ago. But Chip and Curtis are still around. They're retired retired hippies. And so for the Chicago Biennial, Chip and I had done a couple studios together at Columbia. And so for the Biennial, we proposed that WorkAC and Ant Farm would team up together and do a project. And so we started kind of like we did with 49 Cities. We were looking at... We chose three seminal ant farm projects, the house, the building, and the city, and kind of reread them and worked together. One of the things about Ant Farm is their archive and studio burned down in 1976. That was 78, 10 years after they were formed in 1968. And when their studio burned down, they shut down the operation and stopped being Ant Farm. So they were only in existence for 10 years. But in the 10 years, they did an incredible array of projects. But a lot of their archive was lost. So we started with the House of the Century, which has this form. I've never seen this form before. It doesn't remind me of anything. And an incredible interior. But all the drawings that existed were very early sketches, and they had never drawn what they had actually built. They built it themselves. And so we started with this project creating as-built drawings. So we kind of worked with Curtis and Chip to kind of remember what the project was like and looked at these photographs and created these new drawings of the House of the Century. It's called the House of the Century, which was a joke by the husband. At one point when they were talking about the budget, he said, you know, this is going to be the House of the Century. And they were like, oh, yeah, we're going to call it the House of the Century. And so we're kind of recreating these, creating these drawings that never existed. And then we looked at this project called the Dolphin Embassy. So this was an idea about a kind of floating experiment station where dolphins and humans would be able to communicate and interact. It only really existed in these two drawings, this axonometric and this kind of crazy cutaway section. And so we worked with Curtis to recreate, to give it, it was never given a scale. So we basically kind of recreated the whole project and in 3D and then cut a series of plans and sections to really kind of understand the project in a way that even Curtis hadn't understood when he had done the original drawings. So this is the sections that had never existed before of the project. And then the last was Convention City, which is this kind of political satire about a huge hotel and a convention floor. And these drawings were completely lost in the fire, so we simply recreated them. And then together we, so having done that, we kind of felt like we really understood ant farm and their process, and we wanted to kind of channel it and create a work AC project that was also a collaboration with ant farm. And so we started sending sketches back and forth to San Francisco about this idea of a kind of project that combined every aspects of all three of the projects. So it was a kind of city scale project, a floating city that would be unbound by any national boundary to kind of be a place of discussion and debate about climate change and sea level rise and things like that. And so we kind of sketched back and forth and eventually came up with this form for this kind of floating city with all the housing around the perimeter. And then these kind of inflatable infrastructure for the living spaces that look something like this. So the idea is it's a kind of translation of another ant farm project, the truck stop network where they drove around in a truck. So instead of a truck, it would be, instead of an American project, it's a post-American project. And then, so this is the thing, a kind of perimeter of housing over this vast space of participation and debate. So this is this kind of moment where the dolphins, again, and the whales can kind of come and meet with people in this auditorium. And then this is the floating city with this kind of photovoltaic shingles and then all this infrastructure. So these are inflatable. The horizontal infrastructure is these inflatable tubes that create private spaces. And then vertically, it's a kind of series of holes like in our Wieden and Kennedy project. So the inflatable tubes kind of distribute infrastructure around the outside and create these private spaces for one or two people. And then the vertical spaces are the collective spaces. And that's it. Thanks. And that's my daughter.
Thank you for the really inspiring talk. Would you take some questions?
Sure, yeah, definitely.
Actually, I'm going to start with a question.
Okay.
I'm not watching my manner because I have so many. It's really, your work is really fascinating. Each one from the small scale to the big scale, it's so complex and so rich with layers and layers of ideas in connection with nature, ecology, infrastructure, and for the ones abroad, like in Russia or in Africa, I imagine you would have to deal with the different culture and possibly politics and policies. So I wonder if you could enlighten us your design process to arrive at something so complex and so
right.
Wonderful.
Yeah. It always starts with research. I mean, I think that's kind of the ex-OMA part of us, you know, is that we really, even if we are in China and we have very little time, to carve out the time to do research on the region, the project, the typology. So it's not just really looking specifically at that project, but also looking at how other people have looked at that typology throughout time, you know, to really trying to do a very small research project very fast. And we work with a lot of people on our teams normally, so that's another kind of legacy of OMA. So we're, you know, on a good sized project, we have 5 or 6 people really just kind of cranking out to try to think through what the issues are. And then the second is really, you know, because we've done so many projects, in a way, you know, to kind of turn the questions away from the local to the global. I mean, I think that's kind of one of the things I was trying to get at in the lecture, is the idea that, and it, for me, it kind of really comes through in that last project, the idea that the problems that we face are big and global, and in a way we should be beyond this kind of these kind of smaller ideas about cultural representation, and that they can be married with larger ideas about the environment and about cities and things like that. And so, you know, it's not kind of discounting the idea that you need to be very local and very focused, but to recognize that, you know, we are coming from the outside and there are other ideas that are always constantly bombarding us from the outside, and to kind of turn the discussion a little bit, you know, to kind of combine the local with the global, in a sense. I think that's part of the process. But research is the main thing. Just do a lot of research. We still wish we were students, basically.
How many projects do you typically work on a year?
A year? That's a good question. Not that many. Not as many as you would think, I would say. 10? Maybe? 8?
That's an enormous amount of work.
Is that a lot? Yeah, maybe. That seems small to me. In real life. I mean, I think that architects don't pay enough attention to infrastructure in general. So part of it is really just trying to get infrastructure into the conversation because it's always there. And in essence, it's really just redrawing the line from around the building to kind of just outside the building. I mean, you don't even have to go that far to start hitting some pipes, you know? And I think the fact is a lot of money goes into infrastructure, and infrastructure is truly the thing that connects all of us. You know, Republican or Democrat, you know, in a way, you understand the notion that the collective exists, at least in the form of infrastructure. And so, in a way, that makes it a perfect metaphor, but also a perfect space for new forms of public space and other forms of connectivity. So I don't, you know, I think that I don't know whether things are necessarily changing, but I do think there is. And you know, I think that for us, really, infrastructure is pipes, you know, and I think a lot of the smart growth is more about, or the smart cities movement. Is that what you're talking about?
Well, like the priority funding areas in Maryland, where the state's only subsidizing infrastructure in those areas.
Yeah.
They're actually dictating where, unlike like Oregon has the urban growth boundaries.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
At least the policy side of it, starting to understand that.
Yeah.
You know, spread out.
Right.
It's actually subsidized by
density. Yeah. I mean, it seems smart. I don't know the specifics, but I do think, you know, but I'm more interested in what we do, you know, and I think that, because I think that we can't always impact policy. You know, a lot of people talk about architects running for office or whatever, but there's a few people who might be able to do that, but we, you know, we can at least acknowledge that the infrastructure is there and use it for design. I mean, we are going to speak through design. So for me, that's the most important thing. But I think, yeah, those there is a kind of broader recognition that the country at least has infrastructure issues and needs to deal with it. Even just that, you know, when we ran the numbers on a typical suburban development and understood how much cost there was in curves, you know, it was kind of amazing. Like 15%, you could save 15% just by doing grid, you know? It was kind of amazing.
I have a question along those lines, actually. In that same project, you talked a lot In that same project, you talked a lot about other forms of infrastructure, and like you said, in terms of pipes and water, those types of systems. And then when you approached the grid or the pedestrian movement system, that seemed to be treated differently in my mind than the other systems that had a lot of care. And so I'm wondering, can you talk a little more to your view on like pedestrian movement systems and how that relates to both culture and infrastructure?
Right, yeah, you mean circulation in general or? Yeah, I mean, I think that, I mean, circulation is the classic infrastructure. That's the one we know best. And in a way, we have a series of projects about what happens if there are no cars and, you know, what do you do with the streets? For this one, we did want to really concentrate on, for us, it's like the grid is the ultimate flexible, you know, urban, it just symbolizes urbanity in a way. And so we wanted everything to be connected through a grid because you can also expand it ad infinitum. And it kind of immediately gives the signifier of a kind of urban condition. So in a way, there wasn't a lot of thought about that. And we probably could have pushed it further. In terms of the cars, we did have a lot of discussion. It's on a high speed, a proposed high speed rail. So we had a train station there. And we had parking, I think. A parking lot. And we had a trolley system. But we sized the roads strategically so that they're two-way roads that only one car can pass at a time with kind of pull-offs. So the idea would be that we made it very hard to drive. So we didn't outlaw cars, and we had no street parking. So we made the streets narrow enough that there was no street parking. So you could drive all you want, it just wasn't very easy, and you couldn't park your car. That was our philosophy, except in the parking garage. So it was kind of, you know, but it was 14,000 people and there was so much retail and, you know, it was actually a very large area. So the idea was that you could do most of what you needed to do in your car by walking to try to really create a kind of New York City scale neighborhood. Yeah, I can hear you. I can repeat it too.
So I was fascinated by all the projects. I have a zillion questions, but I'm just going to ask one. And I was really taken by a comment that was sort of offhand when you're describing the city, Kaiser, or Nature City. And you mentioned how, if I remember correctly, the people who would live there would be aware of their role in the community because of the role or the function of their building in the system.
Yeah.
And for me, that struck me as very utopian in the social design sense of, you know, it's not just about the form of the city, but it's also about how behavior and the community or the polity that's going to come out of it is going to come out of the design. Am I correct in reading this?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Would you then connect it? Because then, you know, I saw some of the examples that were in the 49 cities, and you had, like, if I could see right, the Fallon's Dairy and the Saltworks. So would you connect this project to this longer utopian tradition?
Definitely. Yeah, I mean, in a way that we approached it with that goal, in a way, to create a kind of 50th city of the 49 cities. But, you know, I think this, yeah, I mean, that was the goal, but, you know, we didn't want to hit people over the head with it. I mean, it is. So people can acknowledge it or not. I mean, it's not like they needed to go, like, you know, work in the salt mine or whatever. You know, I mean, I think people were free to ignore the infrastructure also, although it created all these different spaces. But I think, you know, we did talk a lot about social engineering. That's, you know, 49 cities, the idea was we're not going to talk about the social aspects of these projects. We're just going to look at how they performed, because I feel like since 1972, we've only been looking at the social aspects of these projects, and we ignored a lot of interesting things about them. So for 49 cities, we did talk a lot about it, and we were lucky to have a guy called Gerald Frug on our team. He's a law professor at Harvard who specializes in local governments, and he's like a super interesting guy, you know, who kind of really changed the way that we think about public space. I mean, it goes too far into it. I won't go into it, but you know, what was great about that project, we had a team that we could kind of bounce ideas off of who are real experts in their field, who are thinking about these issues, you know, for their whole careers. And so hopefully a lot of their ideas also came into the project. So while Jerry didn't really think about infrastructure, he thought a lot about what brings people together and how people should live in a city, which essentially is that everybody should live all together mixed and, you know, there should be no division of anything. So. And that everyone should be a stranger to each other.
Thank you so much.
All right, thank you.